this is cut out is not a big deal.
Okay.
For the sound, I don't think. But I like the way this one plays. You know, when I was a student, you know, you just buy stuff. People were equipment crazy, and you just buy stuff, and then you put it away, you didn't see it. And then a couple of years ago, I had to play a Messiaen quartet, and I needed a 66. And I went in there, I said, man, this plays good. So it's just, it's plastic. And I don't think there's anything particularly amazing about it, but I think it does play in tune. It's not, it doesn't have some kind of offset, manic kind of bore. I don't think it's, the bore is so sophisticated. But you play clarinet?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like nerdily hooked up in the inside. Just some of the cats, they have certain concepts of how to bore, of the barrel, the shape. It seems very milquetoast. I grew up in New York in a time, you know, now we have an African-American clarinet player in the New York Philharmonic, which is just a few years after we had a Puerto Rican clarinet player in the Met and then in the New York Philharmonic. But before that, I think things were pretty tight, and I think a lot of the older Black reed players had really given up on playing an orchestral instrument in an orchestra, and they were really focusing on doubling and trying to get a Broadway show. Since, at least in New York, the only ways that you could really tap into what the union was offering in terms of benefits and stuff was either to have a symphony gig or to play in a Broadway show. And so a lot of the older players that I met, they were all really super focused on getting some flute together, you know, whatever instrument they played. And there were guys that played bassoon and oboe, and they just gave that up, and they were just trying to get a Broadway show. For years in New York, very few African American musicians were in shows that didn't have on stage parts. That started with the Lena Horne show. Lena Horne requested that there would be black musicians in the band, and so all of a sudden, a whole bunch of guys, including people we think of as very avant-garde, like the trombone player Craig Harris, all of a sudden these guys had shows. But there weren't black musicians doing work really on clarinet. And I guess I just didn't get that message. And for years I had a clarinet player, clarinet teacher, who would say, you know, if you played saxophone, you didn't play good clarinet. And so for years I just stayed studying the clarinet, just kept studying the clarinet, studying it, being dissed by various teachers. And then I left New York to study with a guy in Boston who also taught in New York. And finally I had a teacher that wasn't telling me my lips were too big, and I just got better. And so for me, the saxophone is like my double. And lately I've been super inspired by this Brazilian saxophonist and flutist named Pixinguinha. And I thought I would play a little bit of Pixinguinha because I'm just super excited about it. I'm really planning this big project where I put Bach and Pixinguinha together. But Pixinguinha, if you guys all know about the history of music in Brazil, I won't say anything more about it. But if you think you don't, I'll say a few things about it. Brazil is probably the last place in the Americas to abolish slavery, way after America. And Brazil and Cuba, all the hot spots in Latin America where there was a lot of development, it seems like they were the places that had slaves and had them for the longest, if you count Brazil and Cuba. And then in the early part of the 20th century, there's a dictator elected. I guess he was originally elected and then he was a dictator, which is the opposite of being elected. This guy, whose name was Vargas, does the usual dictator things, kills people and stuff like that, but he had this great multicultural idea about Brazil, that Brazilian music should be samba. But he adopted samba as the national music in a way that I always attribute to somebody like Berry Gordy, kind of cleaning up R&B so that a wider audience would find it more accessible. So post-Vargas, there's all this music, but the lyrics aren't about the ghetto, you know, like, they're very much about how nice a country Brazil is. They're almost propagandistic about what Brazil is to somebody who's a tourist. The women are pretty, the beaches are beautiful, you know. And so under him, all of these great composers, including Villa-Lobos was under him, but guys like Ari Barroso and Dori Caymmi were all kind of state supported. They also couldn't really leave as much as they wanted to. Like a lot of dictatorships, you couldn't really leave. Pixinguinha was the son, he was born just 10 years after slavery was abolished. And at the time that he was born, choro music, which is a kind of very folky Brazilian music, was already going. And this guy just, he knows a lot about everything, about composition, about harmony, counterpoint, and he's such a killing flute player, and he's my man on tenor. Anyway, I just want to play a little bit because this is really what I'm working on. So,
find some peace in winning you.
That's much later.
Oh, okay.
You know, we can talk about guys like Milton Nascimento and that generation, which is after Bossa Nova. Those are like almost like the Tropicalia cats. Some of those guys studied in Europe. Milton Nascimento studied with Nadia Boulanger, who was this teacher that taught Aaron Copland and Ned Rorem and all these people. She had very few black students, but the two that she always talked about were Milton Nascimento and Quincy Jones. Anyway, here is a little bit of Pishinguinha. This tune just drives me insane. This is called, I have no Portuguese, so it's called Os Dois Que Son Se Gastam. I just want you to check out the twistiness of the harmony and the line. Just very unique. Thank you. is so chromatic and so twisted, convoluted, strange. If you look at some of the early works of Schoenberg, where he's still writing tonally, like the Iron Brigade, and like every second there's some kind of crazy chord change from this key to that key, just one beat here, one beat there, you know, like it's that kind of writing like all the time. But this dude, he's a killing player. I mean, somebody gave him a huge tutorial on late romantic harmony because he just seems to have everything. It's incredible to me. In fact, I really feel like he is compositionally, for the world of composition at large, he's the great omission. He's like, which is why I'm kind of pairing him with Bach. I think he's the great compositional omission. But he worked more in Brazilian popular music, but everybody knew him. Villa-Lobos knew him. Everybody knew him and was inspired by him. But Villa-Lobos was a white guy, he was a black guy, so he wasn't gonna have this kind of concert career. But I just think what he's done is ridiculous. So now I'll play you something that he orchestrated, something with singers.
What year was that recorded?
That's the other thing. Because, you know, the Brazilians get to Europe before a lot of the jazz musicians get there. They're in Europe, 1914, 1915, playing this stuff, which has, at least in terms of the way it's composed, it has harmonic jazz implications. I won't say that Pixinguinha and the kind of musicians that he was around were jazz musicians in terms of creating whole large lines, but they could get around some chord changes. They play a lot of the kinds of scales that you hear in jazz, but they're not exactly improvising with them in an extended kind of way. So Pixinguinha also wrote for Carmen Miranda, all the great singers of the moment, Carmen Miranda being the great export of Brazilian culture. Here's something I just think is amazing. It just makes me so happy. This, I don't even want to say anything about it. This is so badass. Thank you. Good Lord. I mean, because this is, you know, what's crazy. I mean, I don't know how carefully you're listening, but you're hearing flat fives and 13ths and all this stuff that really comes to jazz later. Yet, you can also say that in terms of creating a sustained improvised line that's like the center of what's going on, the Brazilians are behind the Americans, but they're also ahead. Like there's that moment in the first thing I played where he just plays the entire modal underpinning of what's happening, blah, 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 like almost like Train would play 50, 60 years later. And these guys, you know, they get to, I believe it's 1940, it's some time before 1920 that they arrive in Europe. And like a lot of things, the atmosphere in Europe around what we call world music, like, you know, Debussy and Ravel and all these cats would be out to hear whoever came through Paris to perform. And they heard Bechet that way, but they heard this before that. And it's just curious to me that this guy has no reputation really outside of Brazil. That's what's curious to me, because he's the great omission. He is really the great omission. I'll play one more thing, because I just like this so much. Makes me happy. Anyway, this... Let's listen to this. This is him on tenor. And keep in mind, this is before we have Lester Young, kind of creamy sound on tenor. When you hear like Sigurd Rascher and some of the earlier tenor guys, they have a kind of a raspy sound, almost like a Gary Thomas. And he has one of those sounds. His intonation's a little funky, but he's so technically gifted. And his time is great. And he's, what I like about the way that he plays is that the composition is always the thing. It's not, in a way it wouldn't occur to him to take a whole chorus. The composition, including the melody, is always the thing. But here he is on tenor. This is called Três Estrelinhas. Minor. just a... And then right here. And that's a C double sharp for sure. Absurd. I mean, it's, I don't know. It makes me happy that somebody did that and did it over such a long stretch of time. And, you know, he really, to me, he really sets up the kind of popular music Brazilian composer that someone like Jobim is, where what you have to be a Brazilian composer is not a guy that just take some favela kind of stuff and just hooks it up really simply. You're supposed to have all of what's happening in classical music harmonically up until that point, which is what Jobim has. When you hear Jobim talk, he's talking about Ravel, he's talking about Stravinsky. You know, there's one time, one of the documentaries on him, he gets to some fancy stuff that he wrote. He said, "Here come the Russians. Here come the Russians." And then he's running all this kind of mid-20th century fancy, kind of out there kind of harmony. But all of that is preceded by this dude who just seemed to have every kind of harmonic trick in the book. And yet he always writes in the same kind of form that you'd hear a waltz or a Sousa march in. You have an A section. You have a B section, you have a C section, sometimes called the trio section in marches. Trio section is usually in the subdominant key. So it would be based on the four chord. And a lot of his compositions do that, except harmonically they're just all over the place. It's almost dizzying in the past few months. So when I was teaching out in Denver, I was in an environment where the kids really didn't know any Latin stuff other than Mexican kind of things. They knew about banda and things like that, but they didn't know the Latin things, especially the Latin things that had shaped jazz. And then I thought we should do some Brazilian music, and then I started working on this, and I haven't really stopped. It's really, I haven't been this inspired since Lester Young. And that's a lot, because Lester Young really changed my life. But this is changing my life probably in ways that I don't really understand now. But just every day I have to work on this, transcribe it, notate it, play it, learn it. Maybe we'll play some tonight if I can get people to read it. But it's some bad shit, I'm sorry. It really, you know, because I really relate to him as a black composer too, you know, because a lot of what he went through as a black composer was like, there were people that said he wasn't black enough and that he was too black. Some people resented that his group, the Oita Batutas, which means eight bad cats, that they were sent to represent Brazil in Europe. A lot of white Brazilians resented that. They thought it should be something more European. Then, you know, all of these things that I'm talking about, the late romantic harmony, the sense of form, for a lot of people in Brazil, he wasn't black enough. And that really continues. That's part of the continuum of Brazilian music, is that those things are always being debated. How much foreign influence there should be. In the 60s, with the Tropicália guys, there were a group of them that wanted to play rock and roll and dress up like Herman's Hermits. And people, you know, there was great controversy over that, over the idea of how much outside influence should be in the music. and how black it should be, or how indigenously Brazilian it should be. And then its relationship to the government was always in question. So Vargas, I think he commits suicide or something really crazy. He dies. That ends his regime. Then there's a Kubitschek, who was the more liberal guy who built the city Brasilia. And that's where the Bossa Nova guys come in. They come in, and it's a time of openness. It's when Brazil wins the World Cup. It's when there's a Brazilian Miss Universe. Brazil is doing really good. And then a guy after him meets with Castro. And then the second great dictatorship starts, which is the one that affects people like Gilberto Gil and Caetano Veloso, both of whom at a certain point were forced to live in exile from the government of Brazil. So I've been learning just all this stuff about Brazilian music. Like, it's really hard to put what's driving an idiom together from the outside. And I knew lots of people that said they were into Brazilian music, but I don't think they understood all of this stuff. This stuff is, it's in books, but once you get into music, you really see that all these things, sports and politics, all come together in this music in an amazing way. And I've just been, I haven't had much help. There's no English. I'm looking for an English translation of various scholarly works on Pixinguinha, and there are none. He really is the great 20th century omission that should be studied in the way, to me, he's like a guy like Astor Piazzolla. I don't know if you know who Astor Piazzolla was, but he was a tango composer who, at a certain point in his career, was elevated to kind of a concert kind of level, and now every string quartet plays a little Piazzolla. They think they're doing something hip. But he, to me, should be the next guy that receives that kind of treatment, because he's really one of the most complete composers I have studied. And I've really had to work hard to study him, because there's not a lot of notation for the great pieces of his. I'll play one more thing, which I really love. This, I think, is one of the great records of the 20th century. That's a lot of billing, but I'll stand by this. This is called Lamentos. Thank you.
that's heavy.
Oh my God, that is so heavy. The first time I heard that, I was just like, man, this is it. Sometimes you know this is it. That is it. That's really it. Any questions? Okay, are we gonna do some playing? Is anybody wanna play? Let's play something. We have bass player, piano player, anything? Anybody? Yeah. You gonna play?
I play bass.
All right, come on up.
I'm curious, why do you think Byron Gene has gone by the wayside as being one of the greatest composers?
Well, I said that. First of all, he's black. I mean, he was born 10 years after slavery was abolished in Brazil. It's, you know, that's pretty serious. And he worked almost exclusively in popular music, which was really the only option for him. You know, if he was born today doing something like that, he'd be all over the place. He'd be like, I don't know. But I also think by the time people started looking closely at music in Brazil, choro had kind of lost popularity as a Brazilian popular music. When bossa nova comes in, you know, and what's the big event for bossa nova? I would say the big event for bossa nova is Black Orpheus, which had music by Jobim, Luiz Bonfá. All these cats wrote stuff, including stuff that's a lot like this, which you know, the day I checked this out, like there's a whole bunch of music in there. Even Jobim wrote something that's like very much like the second thing that I played, that kind of is background music in Black Orpheus. By that time, conditions had really changed, and there was a lot of phony bossa nova that came, you know, Charlie Bird and that kind of thing. A lot of people recorded bossa nova, but it wasn't like people were looking backwards, because he wasn't really in favor. After the Vargas regime ends, a lot of people associated with it are kind of like, you know, they're kind of like ex-Nazis or something. You know, okay, so, well, you were his boy, so now we have a different regime, and the government isn't going to support you. You know, Villa-Lobos wasn't allowed to leave the country and was forced, like Shostakovich, writing super patriotic works. You know, so the Vargas regime and then the end of it also marked the end of samba as he defined it, and choro was starting to wane just naturally. It wasn't what people were really checking out. I wish there was something I could recommend to you to really catch up with a lot of this Brazilian history, but one of the best things that I know about, there's a documentary in three parts that the BBC did called Brazil, Brazil. And it lays out a lot of this stuff. At least one part of it is on YouTube and you can see it. But the first two parts where they cover all this stuff we're talking about, and then the Tropicália that comes, bossa nova and Tropicália, that's really a must, because you know, this is all stuff I really didn't know. I have to confess. Maybe everybody else I knew it, and they just didn't tell me. But I really didn't know. Brazil, like you think of the music as being so relaxed, not like it came out of a dictatorship. I mean, this dude Vargas wanted to be down. He wanted to be associated with Hitler and Mussolini. There's even, he sent, at a certain point, he piped a radio broadcast to Germany, declaring it is, you know, that he wanted to be down with the Nazis. But then, in the same broadcast, there's all these African people singing samba. So can you imagine, you're Adolf Hitler, you're sitting there, and, you know, like this guy from Brazil is kissing your ass, and then you hear some samba? I mean, wow! That is nuts. That's nuts. Really nuts. And then, you know, who was Carmen Miranda and why was she chosen and what happened to her and how did Brazilians deal? That's a whole story. Because Carmen Miranda comes back from being the highest paid female performer in American cinema. She goes back to Brazil and they don't want to hear about her anymore. All of that happened. I mean, it's a very violent history of music with a lot of debate. There's a lot of debate in the music about what it's supposed to be, what it's not supposed to be, what's supposed to be in it, why do you like it? You know, in the 60s, a lot of people on the left were very much purists about what was Brazilian. And so it was people on the left that didn't want people dressing up like Herman's Hermits, not people on the right. You know, it's all very surprising. And yet, it makes a lot of sense when you start to study it. It's like, oh, well, that's why this is like this and that's like that. Very fascinating. I don't know if the world needs a book from me, but I think a couple of articles may come from this because it's some heavy stuff that a lot of people don't really have a handle on. Yeah.
How do you spell his name? Where did you find all the recordings?
Well, there's some stuff on the internet, including, Pichinguinha. The other thing about him is, it seems like he lost his flute embouchure and he stays on tenor and he joins the band of a guy who plays flute. And so a lot of his mid-career recordings are flute, tenor, and ensemble. I should play at least one of those because that's a whole different sound, like another flute player. I mean, a guy that's much more of a modern classical flute player playing his music. Here's one thing. This I think is super amazing too. You know, I love the things he plays. I mean, it just makes you, but the what I think is also amazing about his playing in this ensemble is that he seems to be running the ensemble from the middle up, like almost like a Baroque keyboard player. You know, like if you really study Baroque music, basically they wrote out changes and cats used to play off of the changes. And a lot of the figured bass stuff, that's what it is. It's really directions for people how to comp. And he is always playing into the voice leading. He's always on the scale, playing through the voice leading. He has an amazing imagination. He really knows some changes. He knows some counter, I mean, this cat is just, he's my hero. So I had, yeah.
How much influence you think like keeping that song or ragtime and written out blues piano music or milonga, like the other types of concurrent music's happened in the America to that early Shura, how much influence you think it might have had on Brazil on a guy like Pixinguinha? Because you were talking
I don't think that he was influenced. I think he was influenced by the entire repertoire of classical music up until the point. You know, let's say up
like
until
European classical.
Yeah. Like Richard Strauss, like maybe not Wagner, but somebody taught him a lot about, first of all, the European forms, which he especially early on adheres, like when we were talking about like the marches and the waltzes and how they're set up. That's very much a European thing. How much did he influence people?
No, I think I was wondering if like other American forms were even present in Brazil. Like
The other American forms were not present in Brazil. You know, like some years ago, they used to have a show called Afro Pop Worldwide. I don't know if you ever listened to that. It was an NPR show run by this African dude named George Colanene or something like that. But he was big on how Africa and Cuba were communicating through recordings. That like, they would hear, the Cubans would hear something from Africa and then they'd kind of imitate that. And so they were playing this game of post office through recordings. I don't really see that in Cuba, but I will say this. You know, my dad played in some of the best calypso music in New York. I mean, for many years, until that kind of dried up. He was essentially the bass player that got used on most recordings in New York of modern calypso, maybe from the 40s into the mid 60s. He was always there. And so I heard a lot of that music. And this music, really, there's some kind of connection there. I think that. And even if there isn't, it's probably ancestral. You know, if you think about people, they're all from West Africa. You know, all the slaves are all from West Africa. They wouldn't be from East Africa and have to come. So they're all Yoruba people, and then they're deposited in the Caribbean, in South America. You know, like when you hear about where the African stuff is in Brazil, it's always in the East. Why? Because the East was the entry, the Northeast was the nearest entry point to Africa, was as far north and east. That would, you know, you wouldn't go down to Rio de Janeiro. If you're coming all the way from Africa, you'd want to go to the place that's the furthest east and the furthest north. And so when people talk about like the African stuff in Brazilian music, they're always talking about the north. Oh, the north is blah, 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 and the north, and that's where Bahia and Salvador, that's where all those places are, and that's why there's such a focus on the Africanness of those places. I'm forgetting your question. I'm just getting Alzheimer's, or maybe it's just the heat. Yeah, I think your original question is about who might he have been influenced by. I don't see the recording industry in Cuba being as far developed as to maybe have Cubans influencing Brazil. But there's a lot of different things. Okay, so like we get to the 30s and 40s, and then we have the whole Carlos Gardel, that he's going to be sold, exported. You know, like Carlos Gardel was an Argentinian singer that they decided to make the Elvis out of. So they made movies with him in Paris, and then they shuttled him all around anywhere where there were Spanish-speaking people in the Americas. He went, he played, he sold records, and then he died like Buddy Holly in a plane crash. That's, you know, the industry wasn't even at that point yet where, you know, a lot of this stuff is from the 20s. I mean, the first thing that I played for you is from 1919. I mean, that's absurd. It's just absurd. It's amazing. I don't know. Anyway, this is what I'm stuck right now. Right now, I'm working also on some Coltrane and whatever I'm working on in clarinet and whatever I'm working on saxophone, but this is really my work these days.
So how do you go about putting those things into your playing? Besides, maybe
I'll let my subconscious handle that.
Okay. Yeah.
Right now, I'm just trying to figure out what it is and be able to play it on an instrument. You know, a lot of this started because I wanted to stimulate myself to learn more flute, and I decided that this guy in the Cuban. Flute player Jose Fajardo, who I could also spend like another hour or two on, would kind of stimulate me to get a little bit of flute together. But what I found out very quickly was that this was all too hard for me on flute. For me, maybe not for somebody else, but for me, it was too hard for me to play on flute. But then I went from just thinking, oh man, you know, this is nice to learn on a flute, to like, man, this cat is a heavy composer. He's, you know, I mean, I went to Brazil for the first time. I was playing with Vernon Reed, the guitarist in Living Color. And somebody said, you know, you need to check out this book. And they gave me a book of Pixinguinha. I looked at it and I played through it. But it sometimes, you have to be ready for something. You know, like, I found over the years that information has its moment. And you could, the same information that'll turn you out a year before or even a month before, you wouldn't hear it. But when you're ready for it, it just takes you. And that's what I think my career is really marked by those things that have taken me that way. Stravinsky, Eddie Palmieri, Machito, Coltrane, Joe Henderson, Gary Bartz, Paul Blais, Verez, Messiaen, things like that that are just like, oh man, this is it. You can always tell. You always tell it's like falling in love, but different. When you fall in love, you don't want to know so much about somebody, because the more you know, the less in love you're going to be. But this kind of falling in love, I think, is pretty permanent. And I just love this man. He's so sweet looking, too. He's just... You know, like, when you hear how nerdy and detailed and meticulous his compositions are. And then you could just feel him smiling. You could feel somebody smiling. When you feel Stravinsky kind of smirking at you. You know, when you hear a good Stravinsky piece, it's a very ironic kind of thing that he's running at you. He's kind of more smirking at you, or almost like a Cheshire cat. Kind of something ironic in the way that he's smiling at you. This guy, it's all sunshine, but in a very studious kind of way. He invites discipline. That's what I like about him. Everything that he does suggests great discipline, and he invites you to discipline yourself. You know, like, when I was studying classical music, I could never really just learn classical music the way that people were teaching it, which was like, you know all the fingerings, and you just one fingering after another. This fingering goes on this beat, this fingering goes on that beat. This guy, he's not telling you to improvise exactly, but he's telling you to know, you know, the amount of chord scale shit that you would have to do to get through a jazz gig. It's that kind of, you know, because he's got augmented, diminished, flat five, flat nine, sharp, he's got it all happening. And yet it's being used in a way where you can see what it is. You know, like when you write some Coltrane out and you can say, oh yeah, I can follow that. I see what he's using, I can follow that. And that's what you get with him. Okay, you know what the chord is, and then you see what he wrote. Man, I can follow that. I mean, I don't know how to say it any better, but like, that was the moment when I realized how meticulous he was about the relationship between chord and modal choice, and that you could really follow his thought process so completely. I don't know. It takes my breath away to just find somebody who I think is just so personally inspiring. Has nothing to do with jazz or classical music, really, and yet has connections to all of it. There's connections to all of it. And obviously, when we get later on in the game and Louis Armstrong visits Brazil and there's pictures of him with Louis Armstrong, okay, at that point you could say that maybe there's some influence. But what this guy did in isolation, I can't really think of anybody I've studied that has accomplished quite this. That they really, you know, if I put some of that in a string quartet, you know, like I'm writing up lamentos for a string quartet, I think they sound great playing it. I think they sound great. And the music's just so touching and sentimental. It's, oh. I don't know. Just and so Brazilian. For all it accomplished, for everything that he accomplishes as a composer, there's something that's so unbelievably Brazilian about it. You just, everything that you have to know. That last piece that I played is a tribute to a soccer match between Brazil and Uruguay. And it marked the first time that a black player starred on the Brazilian team. That's what the song is about. It's about how happy he was. It's incredible. Incredible. Anyway. We don't have to talk. Well, let's come up and play. Somebody come up and play. Let's play something. It's supposed to be a clinic. Let's play something. And then nobody wants to play?
Hey, man, I think it's really pretty refreshing to hear your passion for, you know, following your heart. Because it's like sometimes we always get into these boxes about, like, what kind of music we're playing, or what is this, or what is that, or whatever. You seem to, like, just basically follow what you like. and you pursue that.
Yeah, well, I know what kind of music I'm playing.
Well, I'm just saying, I think that's a lesson for young people that are trying to formulate a style, that it really is based upon what you like and just absorbing that stuff on a very human level. So that's really great, because I know you've kind of been in lots of different genres in terms of jazz, and you know, you play traditional jazz, you play shiro music, and you play avant-garde jazz and stuff like that. So you basically follow your heart, you know, in terms of like what you're pursuing. Wouldn't you say?
You gonna play baritone?
Get you funny.
Go ahead, boy. I didn't mean to interrupt you. I was just happy to see that instrument. You gonna play some bebop on that?
Just a little bit.
You gotta come up. I gotta hear this.
One moment.
Let's play blues or something. No drummer? What was the guy's name that played on the Freddie Hubbard record? In Ready for Freddy, there's a euphonium. You know that record, Ready for Freddy? That's the one that has Bird-like and Crisis and all these classic tunes. And it's Freddie Hubbard, Wayne Shorter, and this euphonium player named...
Julius?
No, he's a French one player. Bernard McKinney. Yeah. Bernard McKinney. So, I mean, you should feel buoyed by the history of your instrument. All
right.
Let's play something. Anything. Blues and F. One, two,
Thank you. Pete and one guy at Snug Harbor with an all-star New Orleans lineup, so check him out. You know, we have to move on. But how about another round of applause to Don Garber?